Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. Alhamdulillah wa salatu wa salam ala rasulillah wa ba'd. So today it's part 7 and it's one of the most beautiful, beautiful subjects that all of us will ever study in our religion. And it's also one of those sciences, one of the branches of Islam that you don't actually need to open up a book to learn. And this is of course referring to our etiquettes and akhlaq. Etiquettes, mannerisms, good akhlaq, not only is it part of the sunnah and it's taught to us within the Quran, but just common sense teaches us how important it is to have good etiquettes, not just with yourself, but with the people around you. The Prophet ﷺ told us that good akhlaq will enter you in Jannah. And one of the most remarkable things about this subject is common sense can take you a long way. And you use your common sense by picturing or putting yourself in somebody else's shoes. How would you want to be treated? And that's how you treat others. So immediately you can place yourself in a scenario where you're the subject and people are treating you a certain way, talking to you a certain way. What is it that you would expect from them? What the tone of their voices, the choice of their words, and just their overall etiquettes, their actions, the way that they present themselves, their posture, and how they stand in front of you. All of these things paint a picture of who we are. Etiquettes is perhaps one of the most important subjects that any human being can ever reflect on, study, and understand. And the reason why is you could have zero knowledge, but when you have good etiquettes, people will love you and respect you. You could know nothing about this world, but you're kind, you're understanding, you know how to control your anger and your lack of patience or whatever issues you might have. You know how to keep all of those things under control. People will accept you. Allah will still bless you with qabul. How many times have we met people like this? You know, when you go into the masajid or wherever you go, at school or at work, you ever notice like you'll always meet someone who can barely speak English, who doesn't have much of an education, who's never really been able to study much in their lives. But they're always kind to you. They always treat you well. They always respect you. You still appreciate the company and the presence of that person. Now, that's today's subject, and I want to go ahead and read to you some of the things that are mentioned in this particular talk that I gave, of course, many, many years ago. And some of the aqwal and some of the statements of the Salaf, rahimahullah. So for example, Abu Hanifa, when it came to etiquettes with parents, Abu Hanifa, rahimahullah, used to have this habit. It's just amazing. He would be sitting in with his mom and they would be eating. Abu Hanifa, rahimahullah, would never start eating until his mother was finished her food first. When she finished her food, then he would start eating. And so some of the students would ask him why he did that. And his response is just absolutely remarkable. He says, "I fear that if I'm eating, my mother would see something in my plate that she would desire and I would have already taken a bite out of it or eaten it. So I wait until she is satisfied and I also wait to see if she sees anything in my plate that she would desire so that I can give it to her first before I start eating." It's just absolutely remarkable, like even these little things that we do that are so routine and such a big part of our lives, but yet some of the greatest acts of mannerisms and examples of etiquettes you find in these moments. Continuing with respect to our Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam, he gave us so many ahadith about having good akhlaq, and I'm not going to go through and say, okay, you have to do this, you have to do that, and now you're a good person. Just keep in mind, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala waited 40 years before he gave the Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam the Quran. He allowed 40 years of the Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam's life until now he was ready to receive the Quran. What do we learn from that? One of the biggest lessons behind that, the wisdom behind that this was the time for him to receive the Quran, was that prior to that, throughout his entire life, he was always known to be an honest man, a loving and caring individual, someone that people could trust. And so his etiquettes were being refined Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala was purifying his behavior and his attitudes. And that's why the scholars say that one of the biggest gateways towards knowledge and towards understanding and connecting with the Quran is to have good akhlaq. Because that's what Allah did with the Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam. Once he reached a point that Allah azza wa jal was pleased with, then it was time for him to receive the book. Now, what's the connection here? You see, when you have good akhlaq, it's a sign that you have good intentions. It's a sign of sincerity. You not only think about yourself, but you think about people around you. That's ikhlas, that's sincerity. You care about the overall well-being of people around you. And you don't care what religion they belong to. You don't care what background they have. All you care about at the end of the day is that everybody is treated well and treated fairly. And so our Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam continues and he tells us in another hadith with respect to families. So how do we implement good akhlaq? It starts with the family. And this is why we have a hadith our Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam told us, خَيْرُكُمْ خَيْرُكُمْ لِأَهْلِ. The best amongst you is the one who is best to their families. What does that mean? خَيْرُكُمْ is a very generic word, khayrun. It's a very generic word to describe something that's pleasing, something that's acceptable, something that's good. So the bare minimum that we are encouraged to behave with our families, the bare minimum is at least be a decent person. Even if you're angry, even if you're stressed out, even if you're frustrated, you had a long day at work, your family is not the people that after a long day of work, you take out all of your stress. And unfortunately, lots of people do this. You know, when dad comes home and he's all tired and stressed out, the kids want to play with him. They want to laugh. They want to jump on him. And he's like, yeah, get out of here. Go with your mom. Go play with your mom. I'm tired. Or he's watching TV or he's doing something else. That's not the point. That's not why Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala puts you out there to work all day. You work and you strive and you struggle so that you can have this comfort time with your family at the end of the day. That's the whole reason you go out there and you do those things. So that at the end of the day, you put forth the hours. Now you wait for your paycheck, you wait for a return. But in the meantime, when it comes to the late hours and so on, when you're home, this is the time where your family sees the best in you. It's a hard thing to do, but it's something that you must do. And so our Prophet ﷺ says this is the starting point. And why is it essential to be good to family? When you can be good to the people you sleep with and you wake up with and you live with every single day of your life, then the people that you rarely see, so everyone else outside of your home, it becomes a piece of cake. You know, patience is in autopilot. Controlling your anger, autopilot. To be an honest, trustworthy, loving, caring person, all of these things are automatic. And keep in mind our Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam, here's another incentive why it's important to concentrate on good manners. Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam tells us that on the day of judgment, the people that are closest, they are nearest to him, are the people that had beautiful akhlaq. They had beautiful etiquettes. And so that's a huge incentive for all of us. That what that teaches us is it doesn't matter at the end of the day how much knowledge you acquire. It doesn't matter what kind of an intellect you might be. At the end of the day, if you can't be a nice person to people in general, if you can't be a good person, then all of that was a waste of time. You still end up potentially being amongst those that are refused or rejected on the Day of Judgment to be in the company of our Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam. Another hadith. Our Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasalam summarized his entire prophethood in one sentence. One sentence, it summarized his entire prophethood. And it's not what you think. He's not going to talk to us about the Quran. He's not going to talk to us about, okay, this is what I did. I fought in this battle. We were victorious here, etc. No. One hadith that is authentic, narrated in Bukhari and Muslim. The Prophet ﷺ says, إِنَّمَا بُعِثْتُ لِأُتَمِّمْ مَكَارِمَ الْأَخْلَاقِ. I was sent down for truly one purpose. In other words, what this means is that everything that is taught to us by our Prophet ﷺ all revolves around this one sentence. And he says, I was sent with this one purpose to beautify good manners. To complete beautiful akhlaq and beautiful etiquettes. So at the end of the day, when we talk about practicing the Quran, etiquettes is part of that journey. When we talk about implementing the teachings of the Sunnah, it's all about etiquettes. And this is what prayer and fasting and all of the disciplines that we have in our religion, this is what it ultimately leads to. It leads to you becoming an overall genuine, dear, good person in society, in this world, in life in general. You know, Imam Shafi'i rahimahullah, when he prepared himself to go and study with Imam Malik rahimahullah, Imam Shafi'i's mom told her son, تعلم من علمه من عمله قبل علمه. I want you, O my son, that when you go and you visit Imam Malik and you learn from him, that you learn from his etiquettes and his mannerisms first before you take from his knowledge. So in other words, go there and observe him, hang around with him, talk to him, have conversations, see how he eats, see how he interacts with the people, see how he dresses, all of these things. And this is why ulama become ulama, because their whole journey through knowledge is complete. It's not just restricted to the theory aspect of it, but even the action and implementation, how they practice their knowledge is what gives them the great status that they have. Imam Ahmad rahimahullah, he had over 5,000 students in his sittings, you know, in his lectures. He considered approximately 500 or so that they were true students of him. They were the students that excelled above and beyond the others. But then Imam Ahmad rahimahullah, it was narrated that many of the students, thousands of the students, who said that when we would listen to him, even though we were not counted amongst his dear students, amongst the special group, we all continued to learn by observing Imam Ahmed's etiquettes and akhlaq. So we're talking about thousands of students just sitting there and just observing. Because again, at the end of the day, ulama are warathatul anbiya. They are the inheritors of the prophets. So what you see from them is the closest thing that you see to the prophets and the messengers. There's also one other statement that I really want to share with you that's just absolutely beautiful with respect to this subject. And that is, of course, with Hassan al-Basri rahimahullahu ta'ala. The great scholar Hassan al-Basri rahimahullah studied akhlaq and etiquettes for 20 years. When we say study, he concentrated on the subject. Now, in the beginning of this video, we said that this is a lot of it has to do with common sense. You don't actually need to open up a book and learn how to be kind, learn how to be loving. That's the fitrah in us. But what Hassan al-Basri is referring to here is that every ayah and hadith and science of Islam that he studied thoroughly and in depth, along with that journey, he also learned how to implement good etiquette. So for example, if he studied salah and all of the ahkam and fiqh and rulings behind salah, he also incorporated in that journey that when you pray, that you're considerate with the person beside you, in front of you, and behind you. You ensure that you had, you know, nice, decent clothing on. You had good hygiene. When you prayed, you didn't distract others around you. You were not the salah police. So when before or after the salah, you didn't start to criticize or anybody. And then in addition to that, even when the salah was over, Hassan al-Basri learned to incorporate that there was a discipline even post-prayer. That, you know, the first thing that he did wasn't to just start to socialize and laugh. You know, some of the things that a lot of us might do. But he was constantly in adhkar, praying, making dua. And this is what the tabi'un, the scholars in general, this is their methodology. This is what they would do. And so brothers and sisters, really the message here today, without good etiquettes, nothing that we learn will carry value. It won't be meaningful anymore. It wouldn't carry the status and the weight and the honor that you would hope and want for it to do. And so going back to Islamic studies in general, everything that we learn about our deen would be against us if we didn't have good etiquettes. And this is something that's unanimously talked about and agreed upon amongst all scholars since the beginning of time until perhaps Yawmul Qiyamah, bi-idhnillahi ta'ala, akhlaq will always be the first step towards receiving the knowledge of the Quran and the Sunnah. And the last and final point, So at the end of the day, how do we acquire good etiquettes? How do you develop that seriousness and that discipline so that etiquettes always become a priority for you? Now, we hinted at this earlier. There's one hadith that literally sets the tone. And it's one of my favorite hadith, and we all know this hadith. We've quoted several times in some of our previous discussions, where the Prophet ﷺ says, لا يؤمن أحدكم حتى يحب لأخيه ما يحب لنفسي. None of you truly have iman. In other words, none of you have real iman. Iman that's sincere, iman that's consistent, iman that's preserved and protected. None of you have true faith in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala unless you love for your brother what you love for yourself. In other words, unless you treat others how you wish to be treated. That's a starting point. Treat people the way you want to be treated. So if you're somebody that's always, you know, involved in drama, involved in problems, always, somebody that no one can seem to get along with, everywhere you go, you stir up problems with people, there's always issues. This is an indication to you. There are some serious discrepancies. There are some serious problems in terms of your etiquettes and akhlaq. And adab, one of the meanings behind it is to beautify. And the last thing that I will say is that in Arabic, there are several words to describe etiquette. So we have akhlaq, khuluq, we have adab. We also have birrun. Just like we say birrul walidain, birrun in the Quran is often translated as righteousness in general. But birrun, it has other characteristics to it. It also means stability in a land. You know, once everything is working and everything is synchronized perfectly, that's also the word birrun refers to stability in that land. So for example, in a city, if you shut off the water supply, then birrun is no longer applicable because there's instability now. There's no water supply for the entire city. But once those things continue to work again, you have to constantly maintain it and constantly service it. That's what our akhlaq needs. Our akhlaq also needs constant maintenance and service. So we're always thinking about ways of how we can improve the way we speak and the way that we conduct ourselves. And this is why one of the most beautiful words on this subject is birrun. Because birrun, what it tells the believer is that you'd never ever settle for the good etiquettes that you have. You always try your best to improve it a step further. And that's one of the most beautiful things about this subject is that it has no limits. If you're loving, it sky's the limit how loving you can be. If you're caring, it sky's the limit how caring, the potential of how caring you can be. All of us are at different levels. But the point is, at the end of the day, this is the priority. This is the starting point. This is the gateway to all khair and goodness in this world and in the akhirah. This is the gateway to attaining true knowledge that remains with you and that's for you. It uplifts you, it benefits you, it beautifies you, it makes you a better human being overall. It's good etiquettes. And so with that being said, brothers and sisters and everybody listening to this, unfortunately, you know, in our communities, this is really truly one of the saddest realities. Good etiquettes in general is something that's almost impossible to find. Just think about how Muslims come out of parking lots after Jumu'ah. You know, just look at the etiquettes, like at least here in Canada for the most part, but I'm sure many other parts in the world do this. We have to get special security. Sometimes we even have to get police officers to guide us out of the parking lot. Why? Because we just don't know how to do it in a synchronized fashion. We don't know how to do it in a way, okay, we let one car go by or this or that. We don't know how to do that stuff. And forget about just getting out of the parking lot. Do you ever see how lots of masajid, how the parking lot looks on the day of Jumu'ah or whenever there's a large gathering? You know, there's one car that blocks like seven other cars, parks by the fire hydrant, blocks the driveway. I kid you not, I've seen this with my own eyes more than once of Muslims that if they're running late, they don't want to miss the salah or Jumu'ah, you know what they end up doing? They literally park right in front of the entrance of the parking lot of the masjid. And then when all is said and done, you think to yourself, okay, well maybe this whoever this person is, they ran in, they caught the salah, but immediately when the salah is over, they'll run back out, move their car, because obviously they've blocked the entire parking lot. And to only to find that that person is sitting there, he'll pray like 4 raka'at sunnah, then he'll pray his nawafil, then he'll make his du'as, then he'll see a friend, hey, salamu alaykum, kaif halak, have a quick conversation, and then he'll come outside. So that lack of courtesy and consideration, all of these things boil down to, at the end of the day, a lack of good etiquettes, to just be considerate and courteous to others. And so, brothers and sisters, I really hope and I pray that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gives us the strength that we continue to improve our akhlaq and etiquettes with each other, with ourselves, and the community at large. Allahumma ameen. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala continue to increase us. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala continue to beautify our akhlaq and our etiquettes. Allahumma ameen. You know, from time to time I forget to do this at the end of the video, but I remember now, so I'm going to do it right now. And we are going to go into my box of goodies here. And this is tomorrow's subject. Oh, wow. Take a look at this, guys. I don't know, because it's going to look strange on the screen. But our next subject for tomorrow in our journey with spiritual growth is the life of the grave. Al-Barzakh. So life in the grave. So we're going to now tap into what the akhirah is going to look like. That transition period that we go from this world to the next. The gateway, the highway, the road, the path that we take to get to the akhirah is, of course, that path within the grave itself. So tomorrow is going to be a very serious subject, insha'Allah ta'ala. And as I'm just skimming through these cards, there is so much to talk about. So insha'Allah ta'ala, stay tuned for tomorrow's discussion, bi'ithnillahi ta'ala, on life in the grave. May Allah Azza wa Jalla give us strength and continue to teach us knowledge and knowledge that is beneficial for us, not against us. Allahumma ameen. Jazakum Allahu khayran, everybody. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala bless you and keep you safe and healthy wherever you are. Wassalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh.